Thank you. team with the circle set. I've got a medieval picture out of one of these books, and it's gorgeous, like this. And it's about to tell the standing up on his tip of his tongue and looking up at the I really like that. It's brilliant. He's even distressed the middle part.
Yeah.
Oh, I've just seen this.
I know,
we're on there. It's not
recorded.
Having created you, I took you and put you in the Garden of Eden to work at Anne.
Yeah.
And we all think it was meant to be some place of worship, but actually it's a place of work. So it was actually, it was a work. That confirmed actually what I thought. And I thought, right, he's dismissing me, I don't know what for. Well, he's not really doing it, so it's not bad. It's a gross response. So I thought, right, well, how do I write a formal gross response? So I tried to take the classical reference into that context, and then I wanted to. I spent a long time thinking about how to present it, and so I wanted to fetishize it. I wanted it as if it was some kind of archaeological find. So it was as if this was some kind of medieval translation from the original sort of Aramaic text of the life. So I created this parchment book from it. And done it in a sort of Gothic style, and then an illuminated kind of form to give it the way that they used to do. That was kind of the thinking behind it. And there's kind of humorous, but there's also a sense of it, nothing changes. It's kind of,
exactly.
It is relevant today. That is what has happened to people. What's happening then?
Challenge, you try to blame me. This is not our centre.
No, that's right. And look at all the chaos that's caused over the past 20 years. To blame me by living in the world.
All the accretions, the men trying not to have a matriarchy. Yeah. I studied medieval studies. One of the pictures that I've kept from those days is of it's a line drawing, and it's a medieval picture, and God is there and he's about to chastise the snake, and the snake, because he says to the snake, you will slither on your
belly forever and be cursed by man.
And it's up on his chin, just looking up at him.
I think I know an image like that. I think I've seen one. It looks small next to sort of this vision of God.
Yes, and God is sort of going down like this.
It's funny. I mean, I'm not a Christian in the sense that people describe it. I find it philosophical. I find the stories even
fantastic. You sound like a Unitarian.
Is that what a Unitarian?
I do, because I'm a Unitarian.
Right. Okay. Do you know? From a philosophical point of view, I'm a Christian. It's fine that I'm happy with it. Because it's also a culture, it's what you grow up with, it's surprisingly influences in the world. So, just a lot of these, I brought quite a few of the sort of references, but not always, that probably should have kind of surprised me that it all came out.
Yeah.
Who knows where that
Unitarians, we tend to refer to them and try and explain a lot of them as well. How it would have been in those days.
Yeah. So it's not a literal interpretation. It's an extreme thing.
It just struck me that it allows doubt.
Yes, oh yes, with intelligence. See, that's the burden of being a member of the Unitarian Church. You have to make your own mind. Nobody's going to feed you, no one's going to tell you, you know, that this is the mystery, don't ask questions, you just bow to it. There's no format except it is an exam.
Yeah, I mean, I did the answer question. I think like a lot of people from different points in your life, I'll find out a bit more. And I'm used to research the people. It often gets me in the head and kind of go out to talk. And I always got struggled with the answers. I've written a book that I came out of this back to. I'd love to find books by a Jesuit. A book by a Jesuit priest who's trying to explain this. And he was trying to say why this was such a big change. And actually, when you read it, I came away saying, this is if God fails to do it. That was the message that came singly. It was so strong. Anyway, I'm not trying to take that for a bit. But I still find that as a challenge. Everybody's getting it. The women are going away from it.
Yeah, so it's
oh, well, yeah.
funny, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. trust in the fact that they do. But I don't know how much I'm going to do it.
Thank you. it's Adam's dismissal from the Garden of Eden.
Oh, sorry, Adam's.
Specifically Adam. Yeah. And that was right one for Eve. I'm the serpent for that matter. But I thought Adam was an interesting one.
Yeah. Such a nice idea, that is.
I'm doing a series of pieces of work around the whole idea of work and redundancy and how we deal with the changes that come out of that. And I started to think about who was the first person, because if that's maybe doing it. I'm not a Christian. Fascinated by it. And I got my Bible, I looked in Genesis, and I read this whole thing here. Having created you, I took you and put you in the Garden of Eden. That's a quote from it. To work it and keep it. So he didn't go in there to have a life of leisure. You often think that's what it means to be. It's actually written as a contemporary, modern letter you might get out of any HR department. With the reference and the information lifted out of Genesis, which is the bits and quotes.
Like in response to my two challenges, who told you that you were naked, and have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat? You said, it's really good.
It's so interesting, isn't it? This tree of knowledge of good and evil. It's almost
I'm not eating.
researching